You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Everyone, welcome to Bio 190. My name is Kira. I'm your instructor for the class. And like we normally do, we go over a few things in the beginning of class. But what I would also like to do is do our live at the aquarium session. So we have Julian and Amanda standing by. Today's class is on wetlands and coral reef. So we will be talking about that to begin with. So why don't we go live to the aquarium to start our class, and then we'll get back to all of the basic things that we're going to be talking about as far as assignments. We'll introduce our guest, Dr. Jenny, today, and then dive into today's topic. So do we have Amanda and Julian with us?
Yes. Hello, Kira and Dr. Jenny.
Hello. And so it looks like we're talking to Julian there. And Julian, where are you right now?
I am at this moment in front of our coral crabs exhibit. At the moment, our live coral exhibit is under maintenance, so hopefully in the end of our short segment, we'll be able to kind of pan over so you can see our live coral exhibit. But I do have coral right behind me at this moment.
Now, most of the coral at the aquarium is not live coral, right? So this exhibit actually looks different than some of the others.
That's right. So if you have ever had a chance to come to the aquarium before, you may want to walk around and compare the different coral exhibits to see what they look like. The one behind me here is actually live coral. And at first glance, I think coral looks like underwater bushes or trees, and some of it can be flowy, some of it can look hard and stiff. But the reality of it is that it's not a plant, even though it really looks like one. Upon further inspection, it is actually an animal, and it's not just one big animal that looks like a tree or a bush, but it is a colony of animals that all live together. And if you look really closely, you'll see those tiny individual animals that are called polyps. And each one of those little polyps are colonized all within the hard skeletal structure of these corals. So I think Amanda is zooming in over here. You can see some of the vibrant colors of the coral we have here in our coral labs exhibit.
Now with the coral, Julian, there is hard coral and soft coral that we'll be talking about a little bit later. But in addition, I know you said they look like plants, but some people sometimes also think that they look like rocks. But there's a hard coral that gives it a hard substrate, right? Can you go over that a little bit for us?
Absolutely. So the hard coral is actually the coral that is behind me. And it definitely does look like a rock, and a lot of it doesn't move very much. But if you look really closely, you'll actually see the polyps up close, and they all have actually related to anemones and sea jellies, and all of those animals have tentacles. And if you look really, really closely, sometimes you have to have a microscope with some of these species, you will see the tentacles. Now, what we're going to do is try to pan the camera over to see some of our soft corals in our live coral exhibit, which is actually on the other side of the monitor at this time. So Amanda's zooming over to our live coral exhibit. As you can see, the visibility in there is not that great this afternoon. There is some maintenance going on, but you may see some coral that is almost a little more flexible and moving. And the coral that's in this exhibit is actually a compilation of hard coral and the soft coral, which is very different. It doesn't have that hard skeleton like the hard coral. So Amanda's kind of zooming around that exhibit to show you that some of the coral in there is that doesn't actually look like a rock. It's actually a little bit more flexible and more and moving around a little bit more.
And one last thing before we let you get back to working at the aquarium there today. Where do you find the coral in our aquarium?
That's a great question. So I am at this moment sitting in our tropical reef gallery, so tropical Pacific. So we have three areas here at the aquarium that showcase the Pacific Ocean. We have a Northern Pacific Gallery, we have a Southern California Gallery, and I'm sitting right now in our Tropical Pacific Gallery, where we showcase all of the tropical species of fish and coral.
So you wouldn't typically find coral, for example, in cold water, right? I mean, we might have some soft corals in temperate water, but hi, Brian. But we don't, that's Brian, our AV guy. But we pretty much don't find corals anywhere outside of usually the warmer waters, correct?
That's right. Coral is specifically found in areas closer to the equator. So the warmer the water, you'll definitely find a lot more coral species. Coral can only live in certain temperatures of water. They are extremely fragile animals, and they live in temperatures that are around the mid 70s to the high 70s. And that's something that you'll probably go over in your class, is the threat to these coral with global climate change.
Awesome. All right. Well, Julian, real quick, before we let you go, we had someone already, Julia, write in a question for the day. So I'm going to direct this one to you. Is that okay?
Absolutely.
All right. It says, if coral is an animal, then what does it eat?
Oh, that is a really good question. So coral, even though it is an animal, it has a symbiotic relationship with an algae. And that algae is what's actually giving the coral those vibrant colors. And get this, the algae has a crazy name. They're called zooxanthellae. That does not start with a Z, that starts with an X. And this symbiotic relationship actually allows the coral to obtain that sustenance and nutrition it needs through the algae, and the algae gets a place to live. So that's the really cool symbiotic relationship that coral have with that zooxanthellae algae, which I'm sure you'll learn more about later on in this course.
Awesome. Thank you, Julian. Thank you, Amanda. Thank you, everybody at the aquarium, for going live with us today. And hopefully that's got a nice kickoff for us today on what we're going to be doing. So we'll see you guys next week.
Okay. Bye, Kira. Bye.
Bye. All right. It looks like we also have our first caller for the day. So who do we have on the air with us today? Who do we have? Let's see. Well, that's me. Do we want to go to the caller? There we go. Hi, Mayor Jamie, right? Are you there? Nothing yet. All right, looks like our caller's gone, so we'll come back to that. If you want to call back in, please do. Again, remember you get participation points for writing in questions, answering the mystery item of the day, or calling in. You can get up to 2 points per week, so make sure you do your things. If you call in, your 2 points are automatically done. If you write in questions, that's a point. If you answer the mystery item, that's a point. You can also email in the answer to the question of the day, or also email in a question about today's lecture for your other participation points. So don't forget to do those things. With that, we'll go on to all the stuff happening. Don't forget, we have Blackboard discussion boards that open up right after this class. Last week's closed today, right before class started. So hopefully everybody got a chance to do that. Also quizzes as well. You'll have a quiz that's going to open up right after this class today. Last week's quiz ended right before this class started today. So make sure you're staying on top of those. Those are good points for you guys to get. We don't want anyone to fall behind. So make sure you're on top of all of your work. Couple of other things. Today I put up the field trip paper. Now last week I had mentioned that we're gonna have the due date on October 14th. However, I'm gonna push that back a week. Let's make it October 21st. So that is up there, it says that. Once you go under assignments, you'll see that it says the due date is October 21st at 11:59 p.m. So make sure that you do that. Now with your field trip paper, the idea is to go out into nature and observe. So we want you to go to a natural setting such as a park, a reserve, the tide pool, something like that. You're going to observe animals. You're going to observe interactions. There's a whole list of prompts on Blackboard under assignments that give you very specific things that I want in that paper. Now, you do not have to do any research. You do not need to go look up the animals and tell me all about the animals you see. I'm asking for very specific questions and observations. One of the things I want to know is, if you see an animal or an observation or during your observation and you want to know more about that animal, I want to know, how would you figure out more about that animal? What kind of experiment would you set up to try and learn more about that animal? And that's what I want you to write about. So again, follow those prompts. I also need a picture of you at that time in your environment. So if it's a selfie at the beach, that's totally fine. If it's you and your family on a hike, that's totally fine. But I want to see some pictures of what you're doing for your field trip. Again, due October 21st, this is worth 25 points. I've also opened up the research proposal. Now, this paper is an advanced paper. It's meant to be more towards the second half of the class, but I want you to start looking at it, start getting some ideas. There's also an example paper up there. With that example paper, read it, go over it. It's going to outline exactly what I'm looking for so you know what to do, but I wanted to put that on your radar right now. That's going to be due a month after the October 21st paper on November 21st at 11:59. I also, one last thing I made available today is the extra credit, our first extra credit opportunity. It's worth 10 points. It's a lab that you do at home. It's super easy, it's super fun, and it has a lot to do with one of the topics coming up. That will be due October 3rd at 11:59. So take a look at that as well. Lots to look at this week. The chapters that you should be reading on that's going to back this stuff up today that we're going to be talking about is chapter 7, 12, 13, and 47. Okay, I'm done with announcements. So we are now going to introduce, oh, actually, hold on. You're going to have to wait. We have some comments real quick. Hold on, Jenny.
They're
hold on.
All choral comments.
I know. I saw you reading. Okay, let's go to the line because someone's been waiting on the phone line for a few minutes. So let's go there first. So who do we have talking with us today? Hi, Katie. How are you?
Hi, I'm good. How are you?
Good. So you have a question for us.
I do. I was wondering how long does coral live?
Ooh, great question. Jenny, do you want to take this one?
I can take that. Corals actually don't have a set lifespan. So we'll talk about this more in the second part of today's lecture when we go into detail on coral reefs. But basically, a coral can live forever. Any given polyp doesn't have a lifespan the way we typically think of animals. The very topmost layer of a coral is going to be what's alive. The topmost millimeters of a coral is the living part, and they just continue to grow upwards. So basically, they can live forever as long as they don't die.
Awesome. Forever. I like it. All right, Katie, thank you for calling in and being our first caller. So you have already gotten your two participation points for the week. Awesome. Okay, Jennifer, are there certain predators that eat coral? And we are going to be talking about some of those predators, so hang tight just for a little bit. And then, Doria, hope I got that right. My question is, why is coral so important to the ecosystem underwater? And we will also be talking about that today as well. So great questions to start off our topic. But before we do that, since Jenny, you've already answered questions, let's learn a little bit about you.
Sure.
So every week that we have our guest speaker on with us, we always go to our speaker and hear a little bit about them, how they got here, and then we'll go on. So Jenny, it's all you.
Great. So my name is Jenny, or some people call me Dr. Jenny at the aquarium. I have a PhD in oceanography and coastal studies. My specialty was studying coral reefs, specifically the health of coral reefs. So the second part of today's lecture is actually what I'm really excited about. That's my specialty. I'm born and raised in Tucson, Arizona, which, a funny side note about that, Tucson is where all of the aquarium's artificial corals are manufactured. So the corals that we have at the aquarium, for the most part, and all of our larger exhibits are going to be artificial corals that are manufactured in Tucson, Arizona, which I didn't know that until I came to work at the aquarium, which I just think is fun. But I was born and raised in the desert, went on to school, go to college in upstate New York at a small liberal arts school called Hamilton College. I specialized in environmental science there. I did a semester abroad in the Caribbean while I was there, in the Turks and Caicos Islands through the School for Field Studies, which was a really cool abroad program. And while I was there, I first became introduced to Acropora coral, which we're going to talk about later today, and the diseases that are affecting them. And then I went on to grad school where I focused on better understanding those diseases and coral health in general. And now I'm an education specialist here at the aquarium.
Awesome. Well, I'm glad you could join us today.
Glad to be here.
Dr. Jenny and I sit next to each other and we josh each other all the time at work. So, got a question from Jessica about how to contact me because you've tried to email me through the email posted on Blackboard. That actually will not get you to my email. The email that we talk about and post during the live sessions, that's the email to email me at. It's bio190@lbaop.org. If we can get that on the bottom thirds, that would be awesome. There we go. Nope, not that one. We have another one. That one, you'll never get answered there either. It's bio190@lbaop.org. So that's the best way to get in touch with me. I have been responding to emails. I check it at least once or twice a day. So email me there. Of course, you can always call in. And we can, if you have extra special questions, we can set up a Skype session and I can talk to you anytime as well. Okay, we also have a caller. Let's go to the caller real quick. Who do we have with us now? So Dominique, hello Dominique, how are you?
Hello, I have a question about the coral.
Yes.
Why is the coral so important to the ecosystem?
Yeah, you know what? Someone else had that exact question just a few minutes ago, and we are going to get to that a little bit later in the lecture. So stand by, okay?
Okay.
All right, thank you. All right, Elizabeth, how many species of coral have been discovered so far? I don't actually know that.
Discovered and are currently still alive, they're, depending on the estimates, hundreds to thousands.
So
the Caribbean doesn't have very many, but the Indo-Pacific has hundreds.
Oh, awesome. All right, and I think it's Jamie or Jaime, I'm not sure which one, but can coral protect themselves from their predators? We're also going to be talking about that.
We've got a pretty cool video that's going to show that.
We do. So as we work through the lecture today, we'll be answering some of these questions. So with that, let's get going on to the lecture. We're going to be starting talking about wetlands, and then we're going to be coming to coral reefs. So, Hale, it looks like you have a question. We're going to be coming back to that in just a little bit. It has to do with coral bleaching and how does it affect animals and humans. We will come to all that once we get to the coral reef section. But first, we're starting with wetlands. And wetlands are kind of something that are local here, especially that we are very familiar with, especially if you go down to the beach and we have a great picture of a wetland here behind us. It's not necessarily like a freshwater, like a stream or a pond, and it's not ocean. It's kind of this in-between thing,
exactly.
Right?
So wetlands are the transitional zone between basically the ocean and what we think of as freshwater terrestrial land. And they can be called anything from estuaries to salt marshes or even sloughs. And they basically are what transition the environment from saltwater to freshwater.
And they have some very special characteristics, like the soil, for example, is kind of an interesting bit of soil, right?
Yeah, the soil is really interesting, and it also has a very unique smell. Definitely
yes,
something
does.
You don't want to smell if you don't feel well. Their soil has a very thick organic input, and so much matter is in the soil that as different organisms are decomposing that matter, all the oxygen in the soil is used up and it turns the soil black and creates a very strong smell of sulfur, which is, wetlands tend to be pretty
smelly,
potent.
Yeah.
Yes.
If you've ever been, I don't know if anyone has driven in Huntington Beach, but if you're driving on Warner towards Bolsa Chica, you've got the wetlands on your right and you'll just get this overwhelming smelling of rotten egg and you just go, the wetlands are really churning today.
Yes.
And that's basically just the decomposition that creates this smell, mm-hmm. right? So it's almost an indicator of a healthy wetland, right?
Yeah, it is absolutely an indicator of a healthy wetland, as is the color of the soil. The darker the soil, the less oxygen is in it, and the healthier it is.
And I believe, did we show the, I don't remember, I wasn't paying attention. Did we show the picture of the wetland soil yet? I don't think so.
I don't think so.
Can we bring that picture up of the wetland soil? You can get an idea of just kind of what it looks like. Not that one. Next one down said wetland soil.
Clay colors.
Yeah, it's kind of a muddy, dark color. There we go. If we can pull that full screen, you can see almost like the mixture of colors going on in there, too.
Yeah, so that's a nice box core chunk of wetlands. So you can see different parts of plant material in there that's in the process of being decomposed. And the different colors are iron getting pulled out of the soil as the decomposing process goes on.
Perfect. Now, wetlands are also known for lots of productivity. So there's a lot going on. They're not normally deep bodies of water. It's usually pretty shallow. And within there, that makes it a nursery for animals. Mm-hmm. It's a good root system for like wetland plants, which we'll be talking about in a little bit. And basically it's just an area where there's lots of life, right? So if we can pull this picture full screen, this is kind of a good how the wetland works image here. So we have nutrient input. What would be like nutrient input, would you say?
A lot of the nutrients are actually going to be coming from rivers and streams that come from further inland. A lot of them wash down different types of fertilizers, so phosphorus, nitrogen. So those would be different nutrients, as well as nutrients brought in from different animals in the area. Fecal matter would be another nutrient that's being brought in.
Sure. So we have all the animals up on the top here, or I'm sorry, organisms up on the top. Primary production, that would be like photosynthetic organisms like algaes, and we've talked about a lot of the microscopic plankton that live there as well. We've got organic matter at the bottom, so that's all this stuff down here. That's where a lot of the activity is going on, decomposition is happening. Of course, light from the sun drives photosynthesis. We've got an output of oxygen and an intake of carbon dioxide. So overall, again, with these shallow waters, this is just a great area for lots to be happening. So we have another comment from Jamie. Does the salt water dominate the fresh water in the wetland, or do they stay the same but in different areas?
It's actually a transition. Mm-hmm. It depends on the wetland. It also depends on the health of the wetland. But a lot of wetlands start, if you're on the ocean side, as being more salty. And then as they transition through, you'll go see different plants and eventually make it to freshwater. So it's really a transitional area.
Sure. And then, again, like we were talking, you'll have like streams and rivers coming to the wetland. But then we also have the ocean tides coming in. So it's really this brackish water, this mixture, and it depends on the time of day, the tide, how much rain has been, so how much offput from the land. So there's lots of different components to the wetlands. What type of animals, this is from Adriana, what type of animals live in the wetlands? We're gonna get there. And then, oops, Hales is still up there, but we'll get to yours about coral bleaching in just a little bit. So we're going to, first, before we talk about animals that live in the wetland, let's talk about the plants that live in the wetland.
Absolutely.
Or just in general, what lives in the wetland, because we have plants, we have animals, we have lots of things. So we'll start with the wetland plants. And again, this is kind of a special case because they have the salt and fresh water they're going to have to deal with, right?
Right. So there are lots of different animals that live in wetlands. There can be anything. There are lots of birds that we're going to talk about later on, different types of fish and other animals. And then there are also a lot of different plants that live in wetlands that help to create this transitional environment. And I think we're going to start by talking about some of the plants that live in the wetlands.
Yeah, so let's start with pickleweed. Pickleweed is a type of plant that lives there. And there's a second pickleweed picture. If we can do this one full screen real quick, just so you can kind of get an overall idea of what it looks like. And then there's a second pickleweed photo that shows essentially the little pickleweeds. And so like these guys here. Well, let me change color. There we go. Nope. Oops, I want this one here. I lied. Yellow. Let's go with red. So these guys here.
The red tips.
Yeah, the red tips. So what's up with those red tips? Because that's kind of something special, right?
So a lot of the plants that live in wetlands are actually a plant known as halophytes, which means they're salt-loving plants. And pickleweed's a great example of that. You tend to find it only covered by salt water during high tides. And what it does is it concentrates all the salt water that it's pulling in, and it pulls it to the tips. And those tips turn red and then fall off.
Yeah, so they can just literally discard, they just discard the salt, right? We talked about that with mangrove leaves and how they discard salt in their leaves, the dying leaves. This is kind of the same thing with the pickleweed. They just drop the little nubs there that are full of salt, and that's how they're able to excrete it. Cordgrass is another essentially grass that lives often in the wetland as well, and they have some kind of special adaptations, right?
Yeah, believe it or not, plants can sweat, and cordgrass is a type of plant that actually sweats out the salt. So unlike the pickleweed, which sweats it out at the tips, the cordgrass actually concentrates the salt at its roots and pushes the salt out in the form of sweat through its root system. It's hollow and tends to carry oxygen from the air all the way down to its roots, and then it pushes it out the bottom.
Kind of interesting.
Yeah.
Love that cord grass. That's a good one. Okay, real quick, some questions from Doria. Is the water in wetlands all saltwater, freshwater, or a combination of both? And that's what we just went over, how it's that combination of both. We have freshwater coming down that's heading like in streams and rivers towards the ocean, but then we also have the tides that come in since it's right next to the ocean, that those tides will bring water in too. So it can be, it's brackish water, but sometimes it'll be a little bit more fresh, sometimes it'll be a little bit more salt. Ashley, what keystone predators are found in the wetlands? Keystone, I'm not sure.
Well,
I don't know.
Keystone predators?
Right.
I can't even think of any keystone species found in wetlands off the top of my head.
I don't know. Why don't you see what you can come up with? Nothing comes to mind for me, but see if there's anything that you can find and let us know. Write back in and let us know. Jennifer, are there ocean animals found in the wetlands? Yes, there are. They will come in, as we said, that this is a nursery for small fish. So baby fish will come in there. There's sharks that go in there. There's halibut, like baby halibut. This is a good place for them to hide out in those cord grass and the pickleweed and all that kind of stuff, and protect themselves before they get big enough to get out to the ocean. So yes, definitely some ocean-going animals there. All right, and then the last one we'll talk about is eelgrass. And this is one that I think someone wrote in last year, but I didn't write it down, so I can't remember. But eelgrass, they're incredibly important as a hiding space for the fishes, as we were mentioning. If we can go full screen on this. You can see that this is like a grass in the water, basically. And it's it deals with salt in a I don't know kind of way.
Unlike the other two aren't always found in salt water. So the first one is only found in salt water during high tides. Pickleweed, cordgrass is found in generally in more salt water, but it has to still filter it. Eelgrass is found constantly submerged in salt water. So I think it doesn't have to deal with it because it's always in salt water.
This
it's
is
not
probably
a
one of those halophytes that is a salt loving example of a plant or grass that lives in the wetland. So if anyone finds that answer, you'll get a participation point for writing in on that one. We'd love to see what you come up with as far as the eelgrass as well. All right, so that's just kind of an introduction to some, and obviously there's a lot of plants and there's a lot of grasses that are around wetlands, but that's just an introduction to a couple of them. And now we're gonna jump in and talk about birds, because when I think of wetlands, I think of birds.
Yes.
This is a major birding spot, and if you love birds, this is a perfect example of a place you can go for your field trip assignment. Tons of birds, depending on the time of year, it'll be different birds because this is a migration stopping point that we'll talk about. But in general, there are tons of birds that you can find, and they're somewhat specialized for wetlands, right?
Yes, and a lot of the birds that live in wetlands, we can understand a little bit more about them by looking at their body structures. So there are lots of different varieties of birds, and by really focusing on their legs and their beaks, we can get to know a little bit more about where we might find them in the wetlands, what type of food they might eat, and their lifestyle within the wetlands.
Yeah, and some are gonna have long legs, some are gonna have short legs. We have a snowy egret here. This is a beautiful bird. We see this right around the aquarium quite a bit. If we can go full screen on this, we're just gonna look at this for a second and just kind of notice the things that make it well adapted for not necessarily living in water, but definitely hunting in water. So what comes to mind for you, Jenny?
Well, right off the bat, I'm looking at the difference in its body color versus its black beak and its black legs. And then it has really bright, shiny feet. I would think that its long legs with those bright, shiny feet, that must tell me something about its behavior.
I like I remember just kind of a funny thing, speaking of the bright yellow feet, the way I remember, there's a great egret and then there's a snowy egret that we can commonly see in our wetlands. And I always remember that the snowy egret is smart enough not to eat yellow snow. So going back to the picture, if you can go back to the picture just for a second, you'll notice that it's got the bright yellow feet. So I think of yellow snow, right. But the beak is black. So it did not eat anything on the ground that was all yellow.
Yep.
The great egret has a yellow beak. That's how I remember the great egret from the snowy egret. Snowy egrets are smart enough not to eat yellow snow. Just kind of my fun thing. Anyway, so yeah, something to think about. Now, we'll go to a video here. We have a got it that will show And this is a perfect example. Now, these godets are actually feeding on the beach, which is right next to wetlands, especially here. So if we can show that video really quick, this will give you a great idea of how it utilizes the feet, the legs, the beak, and everything to hunt on these kinds of conditions. So we'll go to that video. So this is a godet. This is a little bit different than the egret. Same idea, though. You'll notice the long, stilted legs. The long beak, and it always just blows my mind how far they get that beak down. All right, so I don't know if you saw that. Hopefully everyone saw it. They really just dug their head right down to that sound. It looks like they were probably pulling up worms or crabs or something like that. But you can see that their beaks are long and pointing for getting down into either the sand or if there's a little bit of water, right?
Yep.
There we go. Perfect.
Those long legs are often called these birds waders because they're wading into the water with their legs.
So the long pointed beak would indicate a bird that probes for its food in the sand. But if we were to see like a slim sharp beak, that's used for like catching flies and insects. Mm-hmm. So the long beak, of course, is going to be poking into things in the water. Same thing with the legs. And then the feet. Now, if we think about birds that live in the water like a duck, right? They have a fully webbed foot, but they also spend a lot of time swimming around in the water. These guys aren't swimming around in water, right? So it's going to be a little bit different.
Yeah, and different birds that you find in the wetlands have different types of feet. Like the first bird we talked about, the snowy egret, it has bright yellow feet, and they actually use those feet to attract different animals. So they'll actually shake their feet to lure in different fish, and then once the fish gets close, they'll swoop in with their long, pointy mouth and snatch them before they actually get to their feet.
A western grebe is an example of a fish, or a fish, of a bird. Western grebe is a bird, of a bird. Can we show the picture of the western grebe real quick? And then we'll go back and show all the different types of bird feet as well. So here is a western grebe. Again, this is one that does spend time floating around in the water, but they're not going to always have those webbed feet like we're used to seeing on a duck.
Yeah, they have more slim, sharp beaks, and those are really for catching flies and insects.
Uh-huh. Very nice. Okay, and can we go to the image that shows all of the bird feet, please? We'll just jump straight into full screen with that. That's fine. There we go. So here are some examples of different bird feet. Now, again, remember, these are all different types. It's not necessarily water going, but we've got this web, and when we talk about web, it's this part. Oops. This part right here. Acts like a paddle and gets it through the, pushes it through the water. There are some like a hawk. These are used for like grabbing their prey from the bottom. There are animals like osprey, for example, that will hunt fish. So they need these talons that can really grab onto their prey. We've got a finch, so this is probably more for hanging onto branches. Woodpecker. So just some other examples there, the ostrich. All right, Alexandria has a question. Do birds of the wetlands migrate like other birds, or do they stay there all year round? Turns out that they are migrating, and it's just a stopping point. Mm-hmm. So the birds usually have really long migrations, and they're not well adapted to doing this huge long flight without stopping and refueling. And that's why wetlands play such a vital role, that they will stop at these wetlands, fuel up, rest for a little bit, and then continue on their migration. So depending on what time of year it is, depends on what migration is happening and what birds you might see at the wetlands. And then we had another one. Are there eagles in the Southern California wetlands?
Not as many as we'd like.
Yeah, I don't. I've never seen any.
I just saw a couple bald eagles when we were on Catalina Island for the Boeing Teacher Institute. It was more on the mountainside, though. It wasn't near the wetlands.
Yeah, I don't. I don't know. Definitely not bald eagles.
Part of that has to do with the fate of the wetlands. So we're not seeing eagles as much in wetlands. A lot of that has to do with because we don't have as healthy wetlands as we used to. We've gotten rid of a lot of them. And we're going to talk about that a little bit later on.
Abby had a question. How many different types and species of birds live in the wetlands? I think that that's definitely going to vary depending on which wetland you're going to, what type of year, or what time of year. Probably in the hundreds, I would imagine, right? I mean, in a given year, you're going to see quite a few different species. So I don't have an exact number for that, but definitely a lot because there's so many different birds that migrate. All right, so moving on. So we've kind of introduced you a little bit to the birds, and now let's talk about some of the animals that actually live in the water that these birds are hunting. So let's talk about the fish.
Yeah.
We already mentioned fish use it for as like a nursery or a hiding zone. What types of fish might we find there?
We can find all kinds of fish there. We're going to find fish like the halibut, the white sea bass. They really do use these grounds as a nursery area. The fish, the juveniles will grow up in the wetlands, and then once they get large enough, they'll then venture out into the more open water, open ocean.
There are some animals, though, that live in the wetland all year long. Mm-hmm. So there are animals, of course, that just spend part of their lifetime in there, but then there are animals like the bay pipefish, right? This is one that is literally adapted to living in that cord grass.
Right.
It blends perfectly in. It can be fine its whole life there.
There's actually one downfall of blending in with cord grass.
What's that?
If you look so much like the grass and animals eat grass, you might be mistaken for the grass. Mm. So both the pipefish and sea dragons are sometimes mistakenly eaten by herbivores because they're just too good at camouflage.
What herbivores would be in the wetlands?
There are different fish that would go after
just the grass, huh?
Yeah.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. Well, sorry, bay pipefish. I guess it's part, you know, it happens, right?
Hide from some and...
Yeah, definitely. So birds such as the pelicans, the herons, egrets, they're going to feed on some of the smaller fish that will live in the wetlands, such as top smelt. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes, especially in the Bolsa Chica wetlands, we'll see lots of pelicans over there diving down and scooping up fish. Cormorants are another one. Terns we see over there feeding quite a bit, where it'll literally just be this like dive bomb session.
Yeah.
That these birds are just diving like crazy for that food. So it's definitely one that has lots of activity going on, lots of prey. Stingrays also will hang out in the wetlands as well, right?
Yeah, stingrays are found in wetlands. They will actually bite the soft siphons off of clams that they are feeding on. And they also tend to have their pups more in wetlands.
Yeah, so definitely a safer spot in general. Great camouflage for the bottom there. If you go to the wetlands and you just kind of stand still and watch, you can oftentimes see them swimming, and then they'll like just bury in the sand, and then they're totally hidden and not easy to find. Speaking of feeding on siphons, they have flat teeth rather that like crunch and grind their food that's on the bottom. So they can just swim over clams, which are a type of invertebrate, a snail. They have these little siphons that hang up out of the water. There we go. If we can go full screen on this real quick. This guy right here, that is what they stick up, and they are essentially feeding using that siphon. They're siphoning the water, filtering it out. It's helping them breathe. And don't do it too long because the stingray is going to come by and nab it off.
Yes, and we mentioned that stingrays hang out in the bottom of wetlands. It's important to note that if you go walking in a wetland, you're going to want to do what we call the
stingray shuffle.
So it's where you shuffle your feet as you walk to kick up the sand and increase your chances of seeing the stingray before you step on it, and also let the rays know you're coming so they can get out of the way.
Absolutely. And also be very careful about which wetlands you walk in. Some of them you cannot walk in the water in the wetlands. Like in Bolsa Chica, it's all protected. You have to stay on the trail. So don't just go waddling around in wetlands unless you know it's safe to do so. Okay, we got a caller. Let's go to our caller. Who do we have with us now? Amy, hello. Is this your first time calling, Amy?
Yeah, I've sent questions in before, mm-hmm. but none of them have been answered, so I was kind of wondering if they've been going through or not.
Good question. You've been emailing in for the screen, is that what you're talking about?
Yes.
Yes, I don't know. Hold on, we're going to see. What are you? They're saying they haven't gotten any. They haven't seen
really?
Any from
okay.
you yet. So
are you
emailing to the, can we pull up the email? I don't know if we can do the caller bottom thirds. We're going to put up the email. So you basically just email in to that, and then that'll be the question. That's what you've been doing?
Yeah, I've been just sending them in directly from the link.
Huh, interesting. Let's see. I think they're going to say something to me. Maybe not.
Okay.
Hold on. She can call Joy. Okay, so they're saying to call Joy, and she'll see. We'll see if she can help you out. So it's 3.
Okay.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
310.
Got it.
243. 2288.
2288.
Got it. Awesome. Thanks. And then they're saying, do you have, oh, did you have a question?
Yeah, I did too.
Okay, Sherry, what's your question?
Can most of these birds you've mentioned, can they only live in the wetlands, or when they migrate or whatever, can they live in other places?
Usually they typically live around water at some point. Like I'm trying to think, like the Arctic tern, like that's one that has a huge migration. They start up around the Arctic. So they're pretty much all water-based birds, not necessarily wetlands. They could be more of an ocean, like a Arctic tern, for example. But they're not going to, for example, be like a finch that is a forest-type bird that's going to then be stopping at wetlands, at least to my knowledge, right? Would you agree with that?
Yeah, the key with wetlands is that it draws all types of birds. And so you're going to find birds from really all around the world that all congregate at wetlands during their various migration times.
But would they start at a wetland? I mean, or like start, but they're pretty much always water-ish bodied birds, right?
They have at least some part of their life cycle in watery areas.
Water areas, yeah. So, all right, Amy, thank you for calling in. Hopefully we can get that resolved. If not, please call back in and we will figure out something. Feel free to email me as well. So don't forget bio190. I don't know if we have that on the bottom thirds yet, but bio190@lbaop.org. So you can email me there if you're still having issues. If anyone's having issues, do that and we will see if we can get that figured out. Jaceel, what is the most common fish that birds get at the wetlands? I think that's kind of a tough question because there's such a variety that I don't know if there's one that outdoes another. It's definitely about food availability.
Yeah.
They're going to be hunting whatever they can get. It might be the juvenile white sea bass or top smelt.
And again, it's going to go back to the health of the wetlands. The more healthy the wetland, the more diverse the fish population is going to be. But right now, a lot of our wetlands are vanishing, so they're assortment is going to be pretty slim.
Right, definitely. All right, so we're going to move on. We're going to continue to talk about some of the invertebrates. So we kind of started with that clam. It was a nice transition from those stingrays that like to eat the clam siphons. So clams, like I said, are a snail. They essentially live in the mud, and they play a vital role because they're a filtering, they're a filtering animal, right?
Yeah, they're filter feeders. They filter plankton, and they also eat detritus, which is going to be all the dead matter that's on the ocean floor.
Very, very important. We also have lots of worms. Lots of worms that live, obviously it's very soft. We talked about kind of being a muddy atmosphere. And one of our favorites is the fat innkeeper worm. They have an interesting little thing going on here.
Yeah, the fat innkeeper worm, which is the worm shown behind us here, it has a really cool story. They make these U-shaped tunnels, and the innkeeper worm will tend to hang out at one end of the tunnel, and then he'll make this kind of mucus net at the other end, which he uses to catch different types of plankton, and then once he has decided the net is full enough, he will suck it in, eat the net along with all the plankton that it's caught. So just kind of sets a little trap for animals.
Using mucus, no big deal. Let's just snot it out and catch some plankton. It's obviously not snot like out of their nose, but essentially that's what mucus is. So just kind of an interesting way of finding some food. We also have shrimp. They're, for example, ghost shrimp. And lots of the animals that live in the wetlands, they're also adapted to these kind of low oxygen environments. Just if you think about it, if decomposition is happening, that means there's lots of bacteria at work utilizing a lot of the oxygen. So that it could be low oxygen conditions. And let's see, the ghost shrimp can go, it says, up to 6 days without oxygen.
It's pretty impressive.
That's very impressive. So that little guy is
hardy. What's our record? 2 hours?
Oh my gosh, really?
Oh no, 2 minutes.
2 minutes. I was gonna say 2 minutes. Something like that. Something crazy. Like we can't go long without oxygen.
No.
Definitely not 6 days. Other animals that live in the wetlands, we have amphipods, fiddler crabs, tunicates, mussels, all animals that do a really great job in keeping that ecosystem diverse. And now to some of the good stuff. Why are wetlands important?
Wetlands are important for a number of reasons. The first, as we talked about earlier, they serve as a nursery habitat for all kinds of animals, specifically fish, but they're also home to a number of different migrating bird species. So they're really crucial habitat for various animals. They also filter the water. So they clean a lot of the water that's coming off of terrestrial environments, so a lot of the rivers and streams. They're going to filter that water and pull out a lot of the different pollutants and chemicals and really clean that up before it makes it to the ocean, along with trapping a lot of potential physical pollutants like bottles and cans. It'll trap them there so that they won't make it out into the ocean, which really makes a cleaner environment for the rest of our ocean animals.
At the expense of the wetlands, though, unfortunately.
At the expense of the wetlands, yes.
And as we already mentioned multiple times, they are a stopping rest place and refueling station for all of these migrating birds. So just kind of going back, one of the other big things too is that they also protect our coastal environment.
Absolutely.
So if there's a storm or big surf, that's going to really absorb a lot of that energy. All those plants that live there, all those grasses, they really root into the mud. Mm-hmm. And that creates a very stable ground, essentially. So if waves are hitting it, it's really hard to break all that mud away. There's all these root systems kind of holding it in place. Mangrove forests, for example, which are those trees that live in salt water, they oftentimes will line on the coast, and they do a great job of protecting the coast from hurricanes. And there's been some very pretty big studies that have shown that when the mangrove forests have been taken down or basically ripped out, that those coastlines do way worse than the coastlines that still have the mangrove trees.
And that's actually plays a big role in coral reefs as well. They're another thing that helped to mitigate hurricane damage. And speaking of wetlands and hurricanes, in addition to mangroves, Louisiana, one of the reasons hurricanes like Katrina hit Louisiana so hard are because the wetlands have been disappearing. And a big part of trying to mitigate hurricane damage, in addition to rebuilding the levees, is actually to line the sides of the levees with wetlands to try and bolster those wetlands so that the impact of the hurricanes aren't as strong.
All right, we have a couple questions. Alethea, I think is how, I hope I said that right. What types of fish are deadly in the wetlands? Do we have any venomous or poisonous fish?
I'm sure we do.
I don't know.
Well, I mean, stingrays.
Stingrays, but they wouldn't be
step on them.
Deadly
Not
necessarily.
Deadly.
Trying to think, nothing comes to mind.
Depends what wetlands. Southern
True.
California, I can't think of any.
Yeah, I was going to say there's no scorpion fish, there's no rockfish in there, anything like that.
No.
That's a good question. Look it up and let us know if you
Florida,
find anything.
Florida, you might find crocodiles.
Yeah, like the swamps and stuff, right?
Yeah.
Nothing comes to mind, but let us know if you come up with anything. Ashley, you mentioned the disappearance of wetlands that we do have. What is causing this? Overhousing or basically housing construction? Great question. We were actually just going to get to that and the fact that wetlands are in trouble.
Yeah. Actually, over 90% of California wetlands have been destroyed, and primarily they're being destroyed by humans for human use, whether it's to replace the wetlands with beaches for more tourist reasons, or go through and develop the wetlands into shopping malls. Nationwide, actually, most wetlands are transformed into strip malls. It's the number one place that strip malls come from, or previously wetlands.
Yeah, people like I know in Huntington Beach, they've been doing Save Bolsa Chica Wetlands forever. Mm-hmm. They have been trying to get their hands on those wetlands to build houses for a long, long time. Thankfully, the public is speaking out and they're not having it, and that's what we want. But
quite
also,
a bit of it's gone into trust,
yeah,
so it can't be sold.
Which thankfully is going to protect those wetlands. So some of the other things too, you know, when we talk about storm drains lead straight to the ocean. When we think about water that is in the streets, it doesn't go to the sewer. The sewer doesn't clean the water and then disperse it back out like it does if we flush our toilet. The water on the storm drain or from the storm drains, if it's on the street, it goes straight to the ocean. But these wetlands are a lot of times the endpoints for those storm drains, which means that there's lots of pollution. And even though we did, and Jenny mentioned that they do filter out those pollutants, they can't do it all. And if it's an oversaturation, it can just start to kill off a lot of the wetlands. So that's another big problem as well. Sedimentation is another issue, right?
Yeah. So we don't really usually think of sedimentation as a pollutant, but with wetlands and also, as we'll talk about later with coral reefs, too much of anything can be a bad thing. And with sedimentation, especially with all the housing projects and different developments that we've been building, there's lots of sediment that's created that's then washed down to the wetlands, and it clogs the wetlands and actually makes it so that they don't function as well because they're not able to filter through all of the different pollutants that are coming through, and it just slows it down and basically clogs it.
Right. There's also non-native competitors, meaning invasive species. For example, if someone were to introduce an animal that doesn't normally live in the wetlands, that means there's no natural predators. They can, if they survive, usually they go crazy because there's nothing stopping them or controlling their population. One example of that would be the zebra mussel. They get in there and they just eat everything that they could that also outcompetes native animals that help to keep that balance. So that's another problem that we're having. Julia has a question, and right after this question from Julia, we are going to go to break. Well, just because our last section for wetlands was answering this question. Do any endangered species live in the wetlands?
There are indeed endangered species that live in the wetlands. There are species like the clapper rail and cordgrass. Both of those are endangered. We talked about cordgrass at the beginning. Also, pelicans are currently endangered.
Actually, they came off the endangered
species. Did they?
They came
All
off
of
the,
them?
The brown pelicans did. Yeah, the brown pelicans came off the endangered species list, but they're on high watch because they've been having issues.
Well, yeah, and then just recently in the last year, there was a case of a brown pelican that somebody took a chainsaw to.
Oh my gosh.
I don't think they ever caught the person. I think there's still a word out for that.
So many mean people out there. But yeah, sorry, as you were saying. But yeah, pelicans, this was a really big place, but they only recently came off the endangered species list. They went on the endangered species list in the 80s and only recently came off. I think it was November 2011.
And they actually started declining around the 60s because of DDT, which is something that was outlawed, but in certain places it's starting to come back. They used to spray DDT all over crops and also in the streets to prevent mosquitoes. And then they started to find that the DDT was weakening the eggs and making it so that the pelicans were laying eggs, but they couldn't actually hatch because the eggs weren't solid enough.
Yep, they would sit on them and crack them and halted pretty much all reproduction, which was really, really sad. Thankfully, they figured it out. That helped with the ban of DDT. So yeah, just real quick, we have a picture of a clapper rail, if we can bring that up. And then once we see that clapper rail, we will go to break, which is usually about 5 minutes, just to get a drink, get up, stretch your legs, grab a snack, and then we'll come back and talk about coral reefs. So do we have the picture of the clapper rail? It's a type of bird. Looks like we don't have it. So, all right, well, we will head to break, and then okay, they're going to come back to it. All right, so we're going to go to, there it is. There's the clapper rail. All right, so really cool bird, something that you can look up if you're interested in some of the most endangered species for the wetlands. So, all right, it is break time, so we will see you in a couple of minutes, and then we will get started in coral reefs.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
I'm Timothy Hudson, member of the Drug and Alcohol Counselor Program faculty at California State University, Dominguez Hills. Abuse of tobacco, alcohol, and illicit drugs is costly to our nation, exacting over $600 billion annually in costs related to crime, lost work productivity, and health care. What's often not talked about is the emotional and mental costs that people abusing substances do to themselves and those around them. I'd like to invite you to join us for a series of live interactive discussions about addiction in America, what it looks like, how it can be successfully treated, and how you can pursue a career in counseling. Join us each week for information, encouragement, and solutions that can change the future for you and those around you. We look forward to seeing you.
Hello, my name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
Ah.
My name is Kira Mathis. I'm an education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Hello, my name is Maria Rosales. I'm a senior at California State University Dominguez Hills. I'm majoring in Criminal Justice Administration. The reason why I decided to come to this campus was for its great faculty, great location, and friendly environment.
Tune in to DHTV on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era. On this job, safety is our first concern. There's a lot that can go wrong. But fortunately, we have Cal State Dominguez Hills, the only authorized OSHA training center in the Los Angeles area. If you're in need of OSHA certification, or if safety is one of your concerns, call 888-4LA-OSHA and learn how to be safe. Remember, safety comes first. Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
We were just having giggles about something funny I'm sure I'll eventually do once we come back from break one day. Anyway, as we normally do, just to throw some participation point opportunities out there, we will do our mystery animal today, and we'll see if you can guess the answer. Now today, this is a picture, so we're not actually going to be showing anything up here. So if we can show the picture in a moment. As soon as that comes up, that'll be our mystery for the, there we go. So I want to know, what bird does this come from? What bird does this come from? Very interesting looking. I just, while we live here, you can see like these little like almost paddles on them. It's kind of cool. Anyway, I like it. So I decided that was going to be it. All right, so while we're waiting for those to come in, let's go ahead and move on today to talk about coral reefs. We got a nice introduction from Julian today about how they have those hard substrates, but these coral reefs have been around a long time.
They've been around for over 400 million years. So coral reefs really are what set up our marine ecosystems. They've been around for certainly much, much longer than humans.
And we had mentioned earlier, I think it was you that said this, maybe it was Julian, about how they grow on top of each other, right?
Yes, like, and I think in a few slides we've got a really good diagram that'll show a little bit about how corals grow, and basically they can live forever. But when we think of what's living on a coral reef, it's only the topmost layer, the top film, that's alive. The rest of it's going to be the skeleton.
And they grow pretty slowly every year, only about an inch a year, right? I mean, obviously there's going to vary.
Actually most grow less than an inch a year. So the fastest growing coral grows about 10 centimeters a year, which is right around 4 inches, but most don't go anywhere near that. Most are much, much slower than that. Even millimeters a year.
Right, and so it's not very much at all, but they make up some of the largest biological structures on Earth, like the Great Barrier Reef. We can pull that picture up. This will be a great example of how awesome these corals are.
Yeah, corals are considered the longest living animal, and also they can technically be the largest animal. At the aquarium, we always talk about how the blue whale is the largest animal, but corals could also be considered the largest animal with how they reproduce and colonies of corals.
So there's lots of different types of corals, and we'll go over those. There's two main types, though.
Yes.
We have hard coral and soft coral.
Yes.
Hard coral being like the hard substrate, right?
So hard corals are going to be the hermatypic corals, which means reef-building corals, and those are really what we think of when we think of reefs. They form a calcium carbonate skeleton underneath. I've got two examples here. So this is a skeleton from a hard coral. It's hard to make it out here, but you can see that it's white. So this is the calcium carbonate skeleton.
We can actually do a camera up on top too.
Underneath the coral. So I will leave these out on the table here, but these would both be the skeletons that are left behind from hermatypic reef building corals, which are really what form the foundation of our reefs. But we also have soft corals, which would be your non-reef building corals, which are the ahermatypic corals. And they don't form a calcium carbonate skeleton. So they're much softer, and they aren't going to mitigate hurricane damage as much. They don't do a lot of what we really rely on corals for, which we're going to talk about a little bit later on.
Right, and kind of going back to the skeletons here, so this gets left behind,
yeah.
And then more coral grow on top of it.
Yeah,
and essentially, that's why we get these huge, what look like rock reefs, but they're really
exactly.
Coral reefs.
And we have a figure that's going to show it a little bit later on, but these holes here are where the polyps were when the coral was living. So if this were a live coral, it would have a very thin layer of tissue over it, and the polyps would be coming out of each of the holes in this skeleton.
Same thing with this one here. If we were to have a magnifying glass or something like that, you would be able to really see itty bitty holes on each one of these. This branch has probably got hundreds of little holes on it.
And so this would just keep growing upwards, where the polyps just keep building on top of each other and growing layer after layer.
All right, so it looks like we have some questions, or some answers rather, coming in for the mystery picture. Is it feet of a clapper rail? Not a clapper rail. Alexandra, is it the clapper rail? Not the clapper rail. Elizabeth, is it a heron? Not a heron. So good guesses, but still no right answer. Yes. No. Already.
Looks like we've got a right answer.
It's like four guesses.
Usually takes a little bit longer than this.
Julia, is it the American coot? Yes, it is.
Nice job.
Nice job, Julia. If we can bring up a picture of the actual American coot, we have a picture to go along with this. So their feet, if you think about it, right? Actually, no, I'm not going to tell you. That's going to be our question. If you are not watching live, this is the question of the day that you can answer. Why do their feet look like that? So why is there such variation in their feet? With the paddles and the little nails instead of webbed feet, that kind of thing. I want that as the answer. And if you need a second participation point, you can, of course, answer that as well. Paris, is it the Hawaiian? I don't even know how to say that. Do you know how to say that?
I don't even want to try to say that.
Aleikio? I don't know. Maybe something like that. No, unless that's the American coot, but I'm not sure.
I don't think
sure.
It is.
Paris, you got me. All right. So good job. That is the American coot. So I want to know more about those feet for the question of the day. Okay, so moving back on. So these corals are closely related to sea jellies and sea anemones, mm-hmm. right? So they're all parts of the phylum Cnidaria, which means what?
Cnidaria is going to be all of your stinging-celled organisms. So that, as you just said, they're closely related to our sea jellies and our sea anemones. Notice I said sea jellies, not jellyfish. We've started calling them sea jellies because they're not fish. So the name jellyfish is a little misleading. So the sea jellies and the sea anemones. Corals act a lot like those. They also have stinging cells called nematocysts, and they use those to help capture really small food like plankton.
There's a really cool video that recently came out, and it's of a jellyfish stinging.
Sea jelly.
Sorry, I'm going off the name of the video. It's jellyfish, but I agree. I'm a stickler about sea jelly. Anyway, with the sea jelly, or in this case, the jellyfish sting is the name of the video, it shows the nematocysts firing, which is super duper cool.
Yeah, and I think we have the video that you're about to show of the sea jelly, and then right after that, we're going to play a video that actually shows corals fighting over territory and capturing different types of plankton.
So that means so we're talking about sea jellies that can sting in these nematocysts, mm-hmm. but the whole point being that coral also sting. So they have these little nematocysts that we're going to see under a microscope. This is like one of the first times it's ever been captured, but you'll get an idea of how these nematocysts work. We have a picture real quick. If we can show the picture of the nematocyst, and then we'll go to the video so we can just give you a picture and then we'll show you in action. There we go. And then there's another picture, I think, that should have like a little drawing almost. That's the one I want. There we go. Okay, so there's like this little almost like hair thing right here that gets triggered. And so if a little plankton, so like a little SpongeBob guy, right, comes by and legs and such. Oops. Okay. So anyway, if he were to tickle that little thing or hit it, it essentially fires out. It's like a little hook. You can see it's like a harpoon.
It's like a barb.
Yeah, like a little harpoon, shoots out, injects into the little plankton, and then starts to inject the venom. So this is all the venom essentially down here that then gets shot into the animal. It acts like a neurotoxin oftentimes, making it so the little animal can't move, and they bring it into the polyp and eat it whole. So with that, let's first go to our video of the jellyfish. It's called jellyfish stinging. I know it's sea jelly. The sea jelly nematocyst. I think it's actually an anemone though. But anyway, same thing. They all have these nematocysts. So let's take a look at this video and see it up close.
James Cook University in Australia, in Cairns. And here's the deal. I've got the doctor here that's the world expert in animal venom. It's pretty cool. Let's go check it out. His name is Dr. Jamie Seymour. So we have a high-speed camera here, and we're running HD SDI video out. And then Richard is recording it real-time. And then Dr. Seymour here is going to try to trigger a nematocyst, correct?
Correct.
And then once you trigger it, we're going to try to catch it on high speed.
Yep. So if you look at an anemone, we've just taken this out of an anemone, and if you poke it in the side...
So this isn't a jellyfish?
Well, it's related to jellyfish.
Close enough.
Yeah.
Okay, I told everybody wrong. I said we're going to learn how jellyfish sting.
Well, it's the same thing. It's the same process.
Oh, is it?
It's like saying, okay, we're going to work out how a bullet works today. Here's an AK-47, and then if I walk in with a Glock, it's the same process.
You are speaking my language, Australia,
see,
man.
There you go.
All right. We're still not exactly sure what causes the nematocyst to fire, but what we do know is if we touch two leads from a 9-volt battery to the tentacle itself, we can get some of them to randomly fire, which allows us to record it with a Phantom high-speed camera.
Trigger!
There it goes!
Trigger! Have you been trying to capture that?
What are we doing?
Not usually, no. All right, so bringing it back from there. So that was gives you an idea of what it looks like with the venom. Like you can actually see it coming out, how those nematocysts fire. Super cool. Never been seen before. That only came out like maybe a month or so ago. So super awesome.
And then at the very beginning of today's lecture, Julia wrote in, what do corals eat? The next video is actually going to show what corals eat.
So let's go right into that coral war and feeding video. Getting there.
So keep in mind what you just saw with the microscope when we watch this next video, because it's going to show the corals using these nematocysts to sting different animals and capture them and pull them in, and then also sting each other and have a bit of a war.
Right, so they said stand by on that video real quick, so we'll come right back to that. As we're waiting for that, though, oh, video's ready. Here we go.
We expect sharks to be hunters, but at night, the reef itself becomes one giant predator. By day, corals may be passive and plant-like, but after dark, they become active hunters. They snatch tiny animals from the current, immobilizing them with stinging tentacles, just like their relatives, the jellyfish. And they're highly competitive, especially when it comes to food. These two individual polyps are fighting over one unfortunate creature. At night, the corals don't just hunt. When territory is at stake, whole colonies go to war with each other. Once a coral senses another is too close, it launches a barrage of stinging cells, and the enemy returns fire. It's a war of numbers. The coral with the greatest firepower will win. Eventually, the coral on the right forces its opponent to retreat. Another small part of the reef has been changed. Every night this goes on, from one end of the Great Barrier Reef to the other.
It's a really cool video. Jenny actually found that today that shows that competition literally on video. Like,
yeah.
Caught it. Gotcha.
So, and it showed the nematocysts and how corals at night will actually become predators and eat plankton. So a lot of times we talk about corals and how they're symbiotic organisms that have algae that live inside their tissue. That's the way they feed and run during the day, but at night they're actually some pretty fearsome predators, not only using their nematocysts to catch plankton, but also to have wars with each other and fight for territory.
Yeah. Jennifer has a question. So coral are predators who target tiny animals, but are there any predators who target coral? We are going to get to that.
Yes, we are, absolutely are.
You just have to wait. All right, so let's get into this. What we were talking about earlier about how we have this symbiotic relationship mm-hmm. with zooxanthellae, the algae. Now, that's also a portion that gives some nutrients to corals as well, right?
I think we have a diagram that we might pull up that shows the different parts of a coral reef and really talk about what corals are. So depending on how you're using the word coral, you might be talking about an entire reef of animals. This is a picture of a coral reef right here. So you could be talking about anything in here as well as the fish that live there. Or you might be talking about one individual coral head, which might have thousands mm-hmm. or millions of polyps that are colonial polyps, so that's thousands of individuals of the same type of animal. There's also, once you get into the coral within a coral head and you're looking at the individual polyp, then you can see how they actually grow and have at least the hard corals have that calcium carbonate underneath. And I think we have a diagram that's going to show how they have that symbiote. Here we go.
Yeah, there we go.
So in the first picture, the top left corner, that's more of a coral reef where you're looking at all the corals. And then we zoom in on the coral head to see an individual coral. And then within an individual coral, we can see their individual polyps. And then,
so this part right here, right?
Yeah, and then looking at the top right corner, this is a cross section of a coral where the white part is going to be all the skeleton, the calcium carbonate. That's
right
all
here.
The dead coral underneath of that.
Oops, hold on.
So the
this
very
part here.
Bottom part, yeah, that's going to be the calcium carbonate underneath. And so that's the skeleton that is like the coral skeletons that we have on the table here. And then the colored part of that diagram is actually the living tissue that's the very topmost layer of the coral. And within this living tissue, there's a line of zooxanthellae, which are microscopic algae that live in the tissue.
Which is
and,
here, literally.
Yeah. They're the little green dots that line the coral tissue. And the zooxanthellae are actually what give the coral the color that we associate with them. And they, during daylight hours, will take the nutrients that are put off by corals, so the coral excrement,
mm-hmm.
and use that to help fuel the photosynthetic process, which then provides the coral with more food. And in the process, corals are actually producing oxygen and taking in CO2. So oftentimes we refer to coral reefs as the rainforests of the sea. That's actually a misnomer. Their coral reefs are more diverse than rainforest and produce more oxygen than rainforest. So really rainforests are the coral reefs of the land.
Absolutely. And with that too, kind of going back to what you were talking about, the algae are essentially what photosynthesize, producing mm-hmm. oxygen, taking in carbon dioxide, but they also get something out of it too. They get a nice protective home,
yep.
essentially, in that polyp, so they're protected. They get the nutrients that they need there. So it's really like kind of a beneficial thing for everybody.
It's very symbiotic, yeah. It's a win-win for everyone.
Now, one of the other things, in our video, we saw that they will eat the little plankton, or, mm-hmm. but that's not a huge supplier of food. I mean, that is a good supplier of food, but they have to rely on that zooxanthellae for food as well, right?
Yes. They will only be predators eating the plankton when they're really healthy and the ecosystem's functioning properly. So a big part of that also has to do with the zooxanthellae, where they're getting the nutrients and everything's functioning during the day. If something goes wrong in the ecosystem and the coral becomes stressed, they'll actually go into somewhat of a hibernative-like state where they'll kick the zooxanthellae off. They'll actually expel them from their tissues, which, since the zooxanthellae are what give coral their colors, when they expel them, the coral becomes white, which is what we call coral bleaching. And when a coral's bleached, they don't have the zooxanthellae, so they're not getting that food during the day. And they're not going to be feeding at night either. Instead, they're just going to go into more of a hibernative state where they shut down and they're just trying to maintain a status quo and use as little resources and energy as possible until the conditions return back to normal. So they're not going to be hunting at night either. They're not going to be reproducing. They're not going to be growing during that time. Technically, the coral's not dead during a bleach state. It's still alive, and if conditions return to normal, it can actually recover from bleaching.
But we've noticed that a lot of times, because the conditions aren't going back to normal, the oceans are still warming, that we're getting lots of areas where there's lots of bleaching happening and eventually leading to death, right?
Bleaching can kill them if it lasts for too long, just like with hibernation. If you hibernate for too long and you aren't able to, your food sources, your food stocks run out, it will kill you. In addition, there's so many stressors in the environment right now. We're finding a 1-2 punch with coral bleaching and disease, which technically bleaching is a type of coral disease, but once a coral is bleached, it's more likely to be infected or become vulnerable to different types of diseases in the area. And so they're really just being knocked repeatedly by a number of stressors, including bleaching.
So Hale, hopefully that answered your question. What causes the coral bleaching is stressed coral in general, water temperature, pH, something that's really off in the system. It can be reversed if conditions come back to normal. And then it mostly affects the animals, obviously, by making it so they can't survive. And humans, we have already mentioned how important coral reefs are to our coast and those kinds of things. We need our coral reefs to help keep that rainforesty ecosystem in the ocean. Darren, what oceans do most coral live in? Can coral be used for medical diseases? So they mostly live in warmer waters that are clear, so there's not a lot of stuff in it. That's why you'll notice them in areas like, for example, Hawaii, right? The Hawaii reefs are, the water's warmer, and it's also clear. There's not a lot of stuff suspended in it like there is in Southern California. So that's typically the kind of areas, usually tropical, that you're looking for. All right, we had a couple other. Paris, the video makes it seem like the coral are conscious, like they have a brain. What drives these creatures? Because I don't think they have a brain. You're absolutely right. They do not.
It's not a brain like we think of with a brain. It's more of a sensory trigger. So like when we talked about the nematocyst, anything that triggers that hair-like structure on the nematocyst will cause them to start firing. So they're not consciously deciding to go to war with each other. It's more that they continuously grow and expand, and if something, a different coral rubs up beside them, or just another animal brushes up beside them, they will fire against them and try and continue to expand and fight for their territory. So it's not really a conscious, it's not a brain, they're not thinking right about what they're doing.
It's just, like you said, more of a response. Abby, does coral ever hunt during the daytime or is it only at night? It's mostly at night because if you think about it, the photosynthesis during the day are providing all of the nutrients they need while the sun is out and they're photosynthesizing. And at night, there's something called vertical migration where the animal plankton during the day, when it's all brightly lit, they can easily be seen. Oftentimes they're hanging out towards the bottom in the deeper water, trying to avoid being eaten. But when the night hits and it's dark, that's when a lot of those animals will come up, like the little plankton that we saw, the little animal plankton, and they will be munching on leftover algae and any other small organisms. So that's often the times when they're going to catch more of those animal plankton, which makes it just in general, it kind of goes hand in hand at nighttime. Mm-hmm. It's not because of night they're hunting, there's just more food at night for them to hunt. All right, so moving on, there are lots of fish that live in these coral reefs and rely on these coral reefs. One in particular is the parrotfish. And the parrotfish is an animal that secretes like a mucus sleeping bag for it to sleep in. But you'll notice right here, it's got these beaks almost, or like these hard, looks like bird beaks that they use to crunch the coral. And then it turns out that when they eat the coral, they are not picky. They take the hard substrate, the rocks, and all that soft tissue on the outside, they eat it. And that is what is responsible for our white sandy beaches.
Yes. And also, before we leave this picture, there's almost like a spider web surrounding the parrotfish here. The parrotfish creates a mucus sleeping bag that it sleeps in that disguises its smell from predators. And so it kind of hibernates in that sleeping bag overnight and then eats it the next morning.
Right. We have a video for this that we're actually, we don't have time to show it right now, but we will post some video links up for you to watch. So there's a cool parrotfish video. I want to make sure we get through the rest of this stuff before we miss out on the videos. Let's cut down. Everyone, I think, is familiar with the anemone fish or the clownfish. They rely on these coral reefs. There's also lots of sea anemones that live on these coral reefs. And I don't know if anyone's noticed, but the coral reef, like the little polyps, are essentially like little sea anemones,
they
right?
They are. They act a lot similar.
So we get clownfish that really rely on these. They're going to live in those sea anemones, and they are able to essentially not be stung by them because they create a mucus layer, so lots of mucus going on that protects them from their stings. Now, invertebrates that live in the coral reef, I want to jump down to this one because we had a question about predators
yes.
on the coral, and we have to show this video.
So one of them, before we showed the video, yes. is going to be the parrotfish. It isn't actually trying to eat the coral, it's trying to eat the algae that grow on the coral, but in the process it eats the coral as well. So parrotfish would be considered a coral predator, even if it's not intentionally eating the coral. But then the
then we
crown
also,
of thorns.
Right, the crown of thorns. So this is a sea star, essentially, that has like lots and lots of arms, and they like to prey on coral. Good news is that there is a nice symbiotic relationship that we've talked a bit about with a guard crab that lives in the sea or in the coral that helps to protect the coral from these nasty predators.
These are really nasty predators. We've had two major outbreaks in the 1960s and 1980s that they can eat quite a bit of coral, as much as 65 square feet a year each of these sea stars. And when they have outbreaks, there's tons of them in the water.
Absolutely. So let's jump to this video really quick of the guard crab, and you can see him in action. Getting there. There we go.
Thank you.
right. So I just love that video. That song has been stuck in my head ever since we heard it this morning when I was showing Jenny the video. All right, so we're going to jump down. So we see that there are animals that love to prey on it, but we're going to jump down to the different types of coral and quickly go over that. There is fringing coral, atoll.
Yes.
Atoll. And barrier types. We have a great picture that we'd like to show of the fringing reef. I think that's where we're going to start.
It's a diagram that really walks you through. So this is a fringing reef right here. So there's different stages of reefs, and all of these are basically one happens after another, depending on where you are in the world. So an atoll forms basically anytime there's they're right around the shoreline, and then they'll circle the mountains.
Yeah, so basically, like you said, they kind of around. This is a perfect example, like you were saying, like circling here, right?
Right.
Creates a big old circle. And then there's the barrier, which we already saw earlier, which was like essentially the Great Barrier Reef, right? And
right.
What's the difference? How is that different?
The barrier reef is going to happen more when a volcano or the mountain subsides, and so the barrier's left behind.
So like there was a volcano that then essentially was like swallowed up?
If we could pull up the diagram that shows all of them at the same time, I think that's the easiest way to walk through each of these.
There's a picture, Jenny's picture that we had right before fringing.
There
that's
we
the
go.
One.
So that shows how you start with a fringing reef where it's right up against the mountain.
So
and
here.
Then as the mountain sinks and the reef goes up, you are left with the barrier reef. And then once the mountain or volcano is gone altogether because it's sunk and the reefs continue to grow, you're left with an atoll with a lagoon in the center. So they're all...
So this one, like, for example, here, this one?
The far right.
This one here?
Yeah. So it goes from fringing to barrier to atoll.
Got it. Perfect. Yeah, that makes good sense. Like, okay, so like the whole center in the middle there, like the lagoon. Perfect. So it starts here where it's just around the mountain.
Yep.
The mountain starts to sink down. This is where we get the barrier reef, correct?
A barrier reef's in the center.
Oh,
the mountain starts to sink
down. Does the mountain still have to be there?
When the mountain's gone, that's when you're left with an atoll.
Got it. That makes sense. All right. Real quick from Hale, are the nematocysts in coral strong enough to harm humans, or are we impervious to it?
Depends on the coral. If it's a fire coral, it's extremely painful when you get stung by a fire coral. It's actually where they get their name from. It
right.
feels like you're on fire.
All right, and the last couple of things, because we only have about 2 minutes left, hazards of coral reefs. So there are some pretty nasty statistics about these coral reefs that need protecting, right?
It's really grim. Recent studies are showing that by 2050, we may not have coral reefs anywhere, specifically in the Caribbean. The Caribbean's doing really badly right now.
So it's projected that 60% will be gone by 2050.
Worldwide, yeah.
That's pretty sad. 10% of coral reefs are degraded beyond recovery. 30% are in critical condition and will or could be dead in 20 years.
Which is key for us because we need them for habitat protection. We need them for oxygen.
Absolutely. Natural destruction happens like hurricanes and cyclones. So we need our coral reefs as healthy as possible to withstand those. But because of human impacts such as sedimentation, so when large amounts of sediment run into the water, clouds the water up. Remember, they need that really clear water.
They won't be able to photosynthesize.
Right. That creates a problem. We also have destruction fishing practices, where they'll just blast up with cyanide to try
dynamite
and collect
fishing.
The fish, dynamite fishing. And then there's anchors where people are just like scuba diving and walking on coral, or their anchors from their boats are ripping it up. So lots of really bad things. And then we've already talked about coral bleaching just from global climate change and carbon dioxide.
And with all the fossil fuels that we're burning, we're making the ocean more acidic. And because they're made of calcium carbonate, if it's too acidic, they'll start to dissolve and there's no coming back from that.
And we will talk all about that on Global Climate Change Day at the end of the semester. So with that, we are out of time. Don't forget, lots going on. The homework is open as far as the quiz and the discussion board. Don't forget to do that. Make sure you're quoting sources in your discussion board. We also have our extra credit lab that went up. Your field trip paper is due in October on the 21st, and your research proposal is November 21st. If you have any questions, let me know, and we will see you next week. Thank you. Thanks, Jenny.
You're welcome.